The great living American Michael Collins has died at the age of 90.
Yeah.
The following is a statement from acting NASA Administrator Steve Jurczyk on the passing of Michael Collins. Today, the nation lost a true pioneer and lifelong advocate for exploration in astronaut Michael Collins. As pilot of the Apollo 11 command module, some called him the loneliest man in history. While his colleagues walked on the moon for the first time, he helped our nation achieve a defining milestone. He also distinguished himself in the Gemini program and as an Air Force pilot. You know what he did? He took a boatload of kids over to the dock so they could and unload them so they could go up and get ice cream. And rather than tie to the dock, he just kind of idled around out in the bay and waited for them to get back down on the dock, and he loaded them back up again. Boom. Yep. It's the best analogy I can come up
That's
with
not
for the
bad.
Loneliest man in the world, Michael Collins.
Would they draw straws for that? Who gets to stay back with the, you know?
Well, it was just as important part of the mission as anything else.
I guess, yeah.
You know, it reminded me of, I was thinking he might have felt relief when the chuckleheads jumped off, because it reminded me when I was in Wall, South Dakota, and the roommate and the son went into Wall Drug, and I got to sit out in the truck and smoke heaters and listen to the radio and enjoy a little quiet time.
Right.
Exactly
my wife worked at Wall Drug, Kenny. I wonder if they bought some black gold jewelry from Jess back then in the day.
They did.
Collins went out into the bay, and he listened to the Twins game, had a Bud Light, and then when he saw the kids at the end of the dock, he motored back in and picked them up.
Snuffed out his heater.
That's right.
Put a piece of gum in. Yep.
I watched a very confounding Wild game last night. I thought a very interesting game. But with each break, I turned over beginning at 8 p.m. knowing that President Biden had begun speaking. And I had my immediate thought that jumped to my mind is, I am really, really tired of the theater. Can I ask you a question?
Sure.
Why he had a very sparsely filled room. And everyone in there, I'll bet you $1,000. Well, Kamala Harris and Nancy and Joe, they're all vaccinated. They're all vaccinated. Right. Why were they wearing masks?
It's all theater.
It's theater.
Well,
it.
Joe, the
it's
CDC all... hasn't said we can not wear masks fully vaccinated inside. They just said we can
inside,
do that outside. Yeah.
It was so pathetically obvious that they were staging a theatrical demonstration of do what we're doing, wear the... I'm getting tired of it, man. I'm really getting tired of the whole mask deal. Nancy Pelosi wears a mask, but when she goes to get a haircut or wherever the hell she doesn't wear a mask.
You mean when she got a haircut when everything was closed down, but it was still okay for her to go in without a mask on to get a haircut?
Right. That's right.
Okay,
right.
Got it.
I was reading a piece about her when she goes and gets a blowout.
Whoa.
Is that what it's called?
I think so.
Yeah.
How about after one of his final remarks, when she jumped up to start clapping like Randy Moss had just scored a touchdown at the Metrodome? Like, mm-hmm. What is this?
Mm-hmm. This theater, and the theater wasn't just inside, Such. It was the fence around the outside, which is there for one purpose and one purpose only.
Right. May I take a stab at it?
Yeah, please.
We here are virtuous and sainted and delicate, and our ideas are special, and they're the best. And we so fear evil conservative thinking that we must leave the fence up so that we are protected from marauding bands of heathens who would challenge our virtuous thinking.
Exactly. I couldn't have said it better. No, you may not, John.
May I say something here?
No.
After you see, I should explain to people, you did a little rant about this before we went on the air. So I went and looked it up. 3/4 of the fencing that was up was taken down last month.
Wow.
Around the White House and the Capitol.
The speech took place in a setting unlike any other presidential address in the familiar venue, the U.S. Uh-huh. Capitol, still surrounded by fencing after insurrectionalists in January protesting his election stormed to the doors of the mm-hmm. House chamber where he gave his address. This and the fence and this article from Associated Press, all designed to prove what Such just said so eloquently.
Metal fencing that had been around the perimeter of the White House complex for months was taken down. Not all of the fencing removed. Most of the area remains closed to the public. The fencing was reinforced with concrete barriers on January 13th, the week after the deadly insurrection. Removal of the fencing comes days after Vice President Kamala Harris and Second Gentleman Doug Emhoff moved out of the Blair House, which is across the street from the White House. A wide perimeter of fencing was first installed after the protests outside the White House after the death of George Floyd. Perimeter was established after federal law enforcement used force to clear protesters from Lafayette Square outside the White House. Then President Trump visited nearby St. John's Church and the fencing went up. The perimeter that spanned multiple blocks on 17th Street Northwest has been fully removed, and a smaller perimeter of fencing remains at the intersection of 17th Street and Pennsylvania Avenue. And that was last month, middle of last
month. A9 Star Tribune, the audience for President Joe Biden's speech to a joint session of Congress was spread out because of coronavirus precautions. And you can literally, you can actually go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 10 in that section, 12 in that section, 8 in that section. Yeah. It's theater, John. It's
looks like
theater
a Twins game.
Designed to show that conservatives are evil and they're still living in fear of us.
Just what about our local state capitol? Is that still surrounded by fencing?
That's a good question. I don't know. Let me look that up. Let me look that up.
I looked at these people, and I thought, what are you doing wearing a mask? There's nobody within 50 yards of you, and you've been vaccinated.
Mm-hmm.
But is that the CDC rule? Even though you've been vaccinated, you got to wear a mask indoors?
Indoors, yes.
Well, what if you go to an establishment where they don't require the mask indoors, or is that not possible?
In Washington?
Anywhere,
or are you just saying
here,
anywhere?
Do I have to wear a mask every time I go?
Yes.
I mean, if I go to a restaurant in the Twin Cities, what? I have to wear it until I'm seated?
In the state of Minnesota, it is required indoors, yes.
What a bunch of BS.
In fact, I believe that on at least the school grounds that I'm nearby, that I visit daily, even if you're on school grounds, even if you're outside, you're supposed to wear one. They don't enforce it, but you're supposed to have one on school grounds.
There was something so off-putting about it. We've been through this drill a million times. Yes, I believe the virus is often can be lethal. I think it's dreadful. But there's something off-putting about seeing these smug freaks who they're going to wear that mask till the day they die, even though they've been vaccinated. It's driving me crazy. We're doing it here. Walls and his merry band of troubadours, they're all wearing the mask. Let's talk about Walls. Are we going to have a fair, or aren't we? And I think it's an important subject in this state. No matter how corny it might sound, the fair is so meaningful to Minnesotans. It is the one cultural tradition that has survived all attacks. It has survived wokeness. It has survived, you name it, it has survived everything. And that's a miracle in and of itself. And now I'm reading, what are we going to do? There are 93 county fairs in the state, despite there only being 87 counties. 92 were canceled last year.
Which one was held, do you know?
I don't.
Okay.
So far in 2021, only one has been canceled. That would be the Ramsey County Fair, typically scheduled for mid-July. That will not happen. Don Merkins is the District 9 director of the MCCF. What is that? Minnesota County Fair Association?
Foundation.
Minnesota Federation of County Fairs. Mm-hmm. Minnesota Federation of County Fairs. He said it's going to be canceled due to crowd control. With no gates, people can just walk in from any direction, and trying to keep the numbers down is almost impossible, Merkin said. He is also president of the Norman County Fair, which he said will go on as planned. It's the highlight of summer, Merkin said. The event will come with restrictions, including fewer carnival rides, spacing out 4-H events, and no bands in the beer garden to allow for more social distancing. Hope is growing for the Minnesota State Fair. A spokesperson for the fair said the fair will happen, but they're still waiting on changes in guidelines to determine what it will look like. Animals, however, are already on the grounds this weekend. There's something called the Sahara Sands Spring Classic Arabian Horse Show. That was canceled in 2020, but right now there's 160 horses and roughly 300 people on hand this weekend for that big horse show. Now, this is a popular state fairgrounds event won't be there this summer. The Back to the 50s car show has been postponed due to insurmountable restrictions imposed by the state.
When was the when was that show usually held? Was that in June?
Mid-June.
Yeah, that's what I thought. Yeah. Because they're doing the auto show. We're going to be there. So why would there be more restrictions for that one?
Because crowds at the auto show will be minimal compared to crowds at the Back to the 50s.
Okay.
The restrictions, did you see the Back to the 50s, what they said the state fair was trying to put on them?
No, less than
10,000 people at a time. So if that doesn't change before state fair time, then we got issues, obviously. 10,000 people at the state fair, that would not work. I mean, it would work, but...
It wouldn't be worth opening. But what's the problem here? Anybody that wants to be vaccinated has that opportunity now. And we've already been told that the CDC said we don't need to be masked outside. What's the problem here? What are we waiting for?
I have a very uncharitable view of why there is now a level of people who remain unvaccinated, despite the fact that you can go across the street to the Knack Hardware and Lounge and get a vaccination.
Okay.
What do you want to say? What?
I think we've reached the stupid level. These are people that might not even know, never even use the word COVID. They might have no bleeping idea what's going on. I think there's a segment of the American population that is so stupid they have no idea what's happening about anything in life. And
would it be more defiance, though, than
stupidity? I don't mean to be that uncharitable, but we've gone through all the people who are aware that maybe a vaccine's a great idea, and you're now down to a level of people who might not be aware of the damn thing.
How could that possibly be?
I think what Chris said might be closer to the truth. Say it again.
I think it's more defiance than it is stupidity.
Yeah, so do I.
They might be the same thing at this point.
Sorry. Well, but there are some people that don't want to get it because they're still unsure of how their body might react to it. And I don't think that that's stupidity. I think that's a genuine...
Is the entire GL staff vaccinated, with you being the exception, Reavers?
I am not vaccinated, no.
When are you going to get vaccinated?
I'm in discussions with that with my wife as we speak.
I can't believe she's not insisting. Given her medical background, why are you not vaccinated?
Because I have an underlying health issue that I have concerns about getting
BFD.
Vaccinated.
BFD.
Well, that's my decision, not yours.
Well, what is it? Asthma?
I'm not
asthma?
Telling you. Yes.
And Joe, in the last 5 minutes, you've turned into one of them.
Yep.
Who's one of them?
Telling us how to live.
People that we have been fighting for the entire existence of GL.
I'm not saying I'm not going to, Joe. I'm saying I still have more questions about it.
You're not alone. I know a lot of people who aren't vaccinated.
Right.
You're not alone. And personally, I don't really care if you get one or not. I'm just surprised you haven't.
Right.
Given your wife's calling.
Mm-hmm. Trust me, I hear about it daily.
I'm sure
you do. Biden ripped for calling Capitol riots worst attack on our democracy since the Civil War. Go.
Yeah, leave me alone. Go after Biden.
That is what I wanted. I wanted to talk about this since 3:30 in the morning when I woke up. That's what I want to talk about.
All right,
Biden ripped for calling Capitol riots worst attack on our democracy since the Civil War. The first thing that popped into my mind was Oklahoma.
Or 9/11?
The bombing. Well, that was the reason I thought Oklahoma, because that was committed by an American on Americans.
True. That's true.
And do you want me to get technical?
And I've just become more and more incensed about it, Such. Yeah, I want to hear what you have to say about
Kenny,
it.
Kenny, I was wondering why I saw you tweet about that this morning with no context. I was curious why you did that, but now it makes sense.
Yeah, because I'm outraged.
Right.
Go ahead, Joe.
Well, maybe the distinction is that during the Civil War, the Capitol and the White House literally were attacked.
But secession, slavery, state rights, states pulled out before anything happened, remember? Mm-hmm. Before Lincoln could even get into office. Mm-hmm. So that doesn't, so no, no, that's rejected right away.
All right. So you're saying there's been a lot worse attacks on democracy than what happened January 6th.
Oklahoma City, baby. How many died? Over 200, right?
Yeah, but what happened January 6th was disgusting.
Well, there's no doubt about it.
But that doesn't mean it's number one in your ratings. I get it.
But again, it's what you discussed earlier. It's theater. It's meant to keep Americans afraid of conservatives. And outrageous hyperbole like that is theater.
Well, unless I've angered, if I have angered GLers by wondering why Reavers doesn't have a shot, I have not become one of them. I'll start over. I looked at that scene last night with Biden slowly taking off his mask and the two gals behind him remaining masked, as did everyone in the room. And I thought, this is tiring. This is sending a message that is becoming tiring. I've had it with the theater. I've had it with the idea that that's doing anything for me. I did what you wanted me to do. I'm double vaccinated. I ain't wearing no mask if I don't have to.
I'm wondering how delicately to bring this up, and I don't know the original source of the quote, but isn't the ultimate sign of control is fear?
Exactly.
Yes.
Okay.
Exactly.
There's your answer.
But I didn't look at those morons last night and have fear.
Don't, because you're not an idiot.
Well, not as far as you know.
Well, but what I'm saying is there are so many Americans who are, and I know some personally, that are still so, even though they're vaccinated, they're still so fearful of this virus, not diminishing it, but they are still fearful of it. So therefore, they are still under control to a certain degree by the government.
And boy, it really helps that control factor when you turn in for his 100-day speech, and there they all are, dutifully wearing masks.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, drove me crazy. It was the first thought I had. Wait a minute. You're all vaccinated, and there's about 15 of you in a room that holds 2,000. What the hell are you doing? Well, I now know what they're doing. They're sending signals. Smoke rings.
Who's going to pay for all that, by the way?
Speaking of that, 200, and this is where it just gets really foggy, $200 billion to provide free preschool to all 3- and 4-year-olds. Huh? $109 billion to offer 2 years of free community college to all Americans. What? Increase the maximum Pell Grant Award, $1,400 per student. Childcare. What the hell is $225 billion to subsidize childcare for families and support child? What does any of that even mean? What are we talking about here?
Free daycare, which I would have loved about 6 years ago.
$225 billion for family medical leave program, and on and on and on.
This is his cradle to grave plan. This is what they've wanted for ages.
Socialism.
That's what this is.
Got the right guy in place. There's no earthly idea how to pay for any of this. You can raise all the taxes you want on Gates and Buffett and the rest of them, and that still isn't going to be enough, which means they have to come after you, middle class. That would just mean that Biden was lying. But here's the only thing I can keep telling you. Biden has been a career failure for 45 years in this sense. What has he ever accomplished? What has he ever accomplished? He got in that salon, and he's been coasting along just like a sweetheart. None of this is going to happen, or let me change it a degree. Everything he's proposing might happen, but certainly not to the degree he is proposing. Government's too big. They can't make this stuff happen. It's too big. It's too out of their control. So he does what he has done his entire career. He speaks a really good game, and none of it's going to mean anything. That's your only hope you can cling to.
Well, at least he's not mean like the previous guy. Yet we're going to be completely bankrupt, or we already
are. The hope is 4 years down the road. That's where the hope is. Meanwhile, what needs to change within the Republican Party and the conservatives to where we can actually offer hope?
Well, Biden had just purchased so many votes. Biden last night just purchased so many votes with these false promises that what the hell can the Republicans do to make a dent in this? Are there enough Americans with the fiduciary responsibility to wonder what the hell the future is going to hold for this country? Do they even care? Do they even care? These are, he needs trillions of dollars to pull this off. Trillions and trillions of dollars to pull this off. Where's he going to get it? There aren't enough rich people. So that means he's coming after you. Well, he's got no other option if he tries to pull this off. So you're out there and you're smug in your 82 grand a year job and you think the world's out to get you and you think Biden's the answer. Wait till your taxes get hit. Because he can't pay for this without everybody. If, in fact, he's going to pull this off, I don't think he will. I do not think he will.
Well, he might not this time.
But, God, what a disappointment this guy's been.
But this socialist wish list is not going anywhere. It's just going to keep continuing for the next 3.5 years.
Meanwhile,
you have to hope that nothing will happen to it.
Instead of flogging on this, what we need to be doing is talking to Trump Republicans and old school, what are we called? Rhino Republicans. And instead of us fighting with John or fighting each other, we need to get our bleep together. Seriously, we need to stop with the nonsense, get our bleep together, and offer some hope to this country.
Well, if the Trump Republicans are Marjorie Taylor Greene, there is no hope.
Well, see, that's the kind of attitude I'm talking about. We've got to get rid of that. We need to talk to the each side. The rhinos think the Trumpers are nuts. The Trumpers think the rhinos are crazy. We need to start talking, folks, or this is the future of the country.
Excuse me.
Well, there's an element of the Republican Party right now, and you guys know how I feel, that I don't think is ever going to change, and that's the Trump side. And the rhinos, you know, they're, like you said, they think the Trump element's crazy. The Boberts, the Marjorie Taylor Greens, the Matt Gaetz, who probably will be gone, it appears, Jim Jordans, Ted Cruz, what do you do? How do you get those two sides together, Kenny?
Well, that's what I'm asking you.
I wish it would happen. Yeah, I wish it would happen, but how do you do it?
You know, and there's a lot with the Republican Party and their platform that I don't care for, but I hold my nose and vote anyway.
Mm-hmm.
There's a larger picture here.
All right.
The larger picture is that among the challenges a sound, rational, decent Republican Party faces is that the mystery has been very successful in instructing people that they should not like this country, that it's not a good place. They've been very successful in that. And the Republicans I would be most comfortable with or affiliated with would be Republicans who are Republicans precisely because they absolutely love what this country has been and can be without giving away the store. And that country, it's taught in the failed academy. It's in the salon. It's in wokeness. It's in this belief that this is not a good place, which belies people dying trying to get here. But they have successfully, the Democrats and the Mysterians, have successfully sold too many people in this country on the idea that this is a great, big, mean, unfair place, and we're here to help you navigate it.
Wow. Hence the systemic racist narrative.
Yep.
Things like that. Who was the... Who was the rep? Was it South Carolina? John, help me, that spoke last night.
And Tim Scott.
And basically Tim said, Scott, yeah. This is not a racist country. And this was an African-American man.
And the left went after him for it.
And they went after him for it. So you're going to tell a black guy that says this isn't a racist country that he's wrong? What is this?
Everything you said, Joe, you're right. But the only way that they're going to see that they're wrong is when they fail. And I'm worried that when they fail, it's going to be too late.
too late to turn it around.
Yeah.
That's what I'm worried about.
Happy Positive Thursday, everybody.
You want to know how biased things have become? CNN did a very light, whimsical fact check of Biden and could not find an unkind word to say. The media in general are fawning over this guy, and they're telling you that his first 100 days have been the most brilliant 100 days in the history of the presidency, and that he's just an accomplishing whirlwind. They fact checked Tim Scott's response to Biden. CNN did.
Wow.
They fact. Wow. Now maybe they always do. I just can't see it in my mind's eye. But they fact check. They fact checked South Carolina's Tim Scott. His reaction. Scott claimed Republicans support making it easier to vote and harder to cheat. Facts. This needs context. We won't weigh in on what Republicans around the country believe in their hearts, but it's worth noting that Republican state legislators in numerous states are trying to pass measures that would reduce voter access in various ways, which I reject. Well, we've been through it. There are some ways that would appear to be the case. Infrastructure. Scott claimed Biden's infrastructure plan is a partisan wish list, with less than 6% going to roads and bridges. Facts. While around 6% of the roughly $2 trillion bill is dedicated to roads and bridges, when accounting for other aspects of infrastructure as defined by Scott, the total percentage is more than double that. So they got Scott on that one. The plan allocates $115 billion for modernizing highways, roads, and main streets, and $20 billion to improve road safety. Biden's plan also calls for $100 billion to build high-speed broadband infrastructure. And so this is all a continuing way to admonish Tim Scott. Schools reopening. During his rebuttal speech, Scott suggested that too many vulnerable kids' schools were closed to in-person learning during the pandemic, and that they should have reopened sooner. Locking vulnerable kids out of the classroom is locking adults out of their future. Our public schools should have reopened months ago. Facts. While it's true that some public schools have yet to reopen, that number has fallen drastically since Biden took office. Yet critics maintain more could have been done to speed reopenings, and some point to Centers for Disease Control and Prevention guidance from February that slowed schools' ability to reopen quicker. So in other words, it's not Biden's fault, it's the CDC. Oh, anyway, whatever.
So you had mentioned, and I forgot to bring this up earlier this week, but the timing now is actually much better. But you had said something about how the press is treating President Biden much differently than they had treated President Trump.
Oh, God, yes.
So I don't know if you guys caught this, but this was at the end of last Friday's address where, help me with her name, is it Jen Psaki? Is that how we pronounce her name? The White House press secretary?
Psaki.
Here's the end of that press conference. This is last Friday at the White House.
Joining us. Great. Well, thank you, everyone. As I promised yesterday, I promised snacks. I did not bring them in here, but my mother-in-law made homemade chocolate chip cookies for you guys. So there's one for each of you in here. We will do it in a COVID-safe way. But thanks, everyone, and have a great weekend.
Thanks. Thank you.
Go to hell.
She made chocolate chip cookies for everyone in the press.
The in-law did.
Right.